Welcome to our online experience. Here is our pastor with today's message.
The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, verse 7, he says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of powers may be of God and not of us." We have this treasure, the treasure of what? Christ, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, the kingdom of God lives within us. We have this great treasure. And the enemy of your faith is going to do everything he can to assault your stability so that you can find offense with those that partner with you, those that are set right next to you. Brother here, sister there, didn't shake my hand, didn't say hi to me, or parked in my parking space. And you can go on with all types of things that bring offense. The enemy is constantly at work to try to get you and I to be offended at each other and to be offended at God. How many people I've spoken to who said, "You know what, Pastor, I'll be honest with you, I was mad with God." I said, "Well, why were you mad with God?" "Well, I figured that he had the power to stop something and he didn't do it." I said, "Oh, perhaps he has the power to stop it and didn't do it, but maybe have you considered he has the wisdom to know what he's doing?" Oh, I'm going to go find another church that can tell me something different. Amen. See, the Word of God teaches us that the treasure of faith, the treasure of our faith, let me say it again, the treasure of our faith has eternal value. Your money in your pocket only has earthly value. When you die, that money doesn't do you any good. Hello? If you get lost on an island somewhere in the Caribbean, that money doesn't do you any good. But your faith has eternal value. This is why we must develop and save and develop our faith and build a bank account of faith. Because we're going to need to use that faith in a time of crisis, in a time of a storm, in a time of persecution, in a time of trials or error or trial and difficulty. God never promised you that you would never go through a difficult season. But it's in that season that you go through that you're able to stand. When other men and women have fallen, you're able to stand because you have put your faith in the Word of God that does not shift with the sands of life. The Word of God is a solid thing, a solid foundation. And every child of God has got to develop a relationship with the Word of God. Somebody give God some glory. Somebody give God praise. The Word of God, He tells us eternal treasure. Matthew, the 24th chapter, these are what the words of Jesus, He said in verse 6. He says, "And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled." Don't be troubled. The world right now, some people are stockpiling. They're stockpiling water and food. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing to do. Some people are stockpiling and they're really looking to go underground into their canoes underground to get through the season that may come. If there's a nuclear war, a nuclear fallout, we'll be safe. I don't know about you. Maybe I'm just weird, but I don't particularly want to be here if the whole place is destroyed anyway. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You know, be the last 15 people alive. That's a miserable thing. Where's everybody gone? Where's my kids? They're gone. Where's my wife? They're gone. Why am I here? Hello, somebody. Because you hid yourself. Hello. And I'm not saying, you know, you're suicidal, but I'm just thinking about that. I don't want to be the last 15 people on the earth alive. We all survived. Two women and nine men. Come on. We got some problems coming up. But he says here, "You shall hear rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things what must come to pass, but the end is not yet." Let me say it again, but the end is not yet. Well, you know, they said that the greenhouse gases is going to destroy the earth in 12 years. That was 2 years ago, so I guess we got 10 more years to live. Now, let me say this. Honestly, if you honestly believe that we only have 10 more years to live, why are you working? Wait a minute. Let me talk to these Lutherans over here. Amen. You got 10 more years to be alive. So why are you working for a retirement plan and you're saving for the future? Wouldn't it be if you knew you only had 10 more years that you would either do one or two things: eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, or preach, pray, and seek the Lord? But see, it all depends on how your mind swings. If you've got a renewed mind, you'll say, "I got 10 more years left. Okay, my kids is born, they'll be just 11 years old or so. Okay, that's all we got. Okay, what we're going to do, Dad? We're going to press in." We're going to press in. What are we pressing into? We're going to press in so that we can endure until the end. So these yahoos who are saying this stuff, they don't really believe that. Have you seen the gold commercials? You can buy U.S. Mint gold. Only for $49.95, you can get this gold to secure your future. Well, let me ask you, why am I buying the gold, Charlie Chan? I'll tell you why you're buying the gold. You're buying the gold so that you can survive when the money falls out. Now, let's get this straight, my friend. So you want the money that I have that's going to fall out for your gold. Now, either you are a nutcase, or you know something that nobody else knows. See, you see how ludicrous it is. I mean, they're telling you is the end's coming, so what you need to do is get you a survival kit. Well, what's the use of a survival kit? if the end's coming. Let me get out there, eat, drink, and pray, and make sure you eat, hello, and pray, and shout, and obey God. And even if I get kicked out of the property, I'm going to only have 9 years left. The Bible says the devil is a liar. Jesus said, I want you to hear what Jesus said. Jesus said, the end is not yet.
Hallelujah.
Well, how do you know? Because he is the beginning and he is the ending of all things. Not the Antichrist, not somebody who looks like Moses. Not our Moses, the other one. Moses does look biblical, though, you know. You see what I'm trying to get you to understand? That people are going to try to shake your faith with whatever they can. Don't let them do it. All right, listen. So he goes on, he says, for nation, verse 7, for nation shall rise against nation. We see it happening right now, tonight. Kingdoms against kingdoms. That's what we're seeing right now. Who's going to control? Is it going to be Amazon or is it going to be Kmart? Come on, they locked you all away and kept Amazon open. And for the small mom and pop shops, they went bankrupt. Because it's kingdom against kingdom. This is what's happening. We're seeing the kingdoms of this earth fighting the other ones. We're seeing the churches fighting. Oh, that's a bad church. You should come to my church. These kingdoms fighting each other. Why? Because they do not believe the word of the Lord. So he says here, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines, pestilence. Just went through 2 years of a pestilence. Earthquakes. We're feeling the rumbles all the time. They're feeling the rumbles in Ohio. This earthquake's going on in Kansas City. Why? Because Jesus said it would be so. You see, the Word of God teaches us in diverse places, different places. So our seismologists are always saying, well, the great fault lines are here, and the ring of fire is between California or Mexico, all the way through Japan, all the way around. And this is what they call the ring of fire. And the reason they call it the ring of fire is because in these places, if you look up the ring of fire when you go home, not while I'm preaching, but when you go home, you will discover the earth, you will discover volcanoes that are in all this ring. What do you think is going to happen? The Bible talks about there will be almost 200 ton molten mixed with clay and iron falling to the earth. But don't worry, you're not going to be here. I'm just giving you a prelude of the movies that's coming. Get some popcorn, get ready for the rapture and watch it from heaven. Amen. How many believe it's going to happen just like Jesus said it's going to happen?
Yes.
So let's move on. So he says here in verse 8, all these things are the beginning of sorrow. He didn't say all these things are the ending of sorrow. All these are the beginning of sorrow. Verse 9, and then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted. Wow. And they shall kill you. You know, I was telling my wife the other day, I said, horror movies, you know, Freddy Krueger, Crooner, or whatever his name is, Dracula, Frankenstein. That used to bother me, Vaughn. You go to a horror movie and see, you know, this guy with this blade, he's killing all the teenagers, and you know, it's like, oh, no one wants to die. And when I became a Christian, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord, far better. Someone comes up and says, I want to kill you. Give me your gold. You ain't getting my gold. I don't care about you dying. I don't care about you killing me. Because when you are that mindset, it takes the fear out of you. But you've got to be a renewed mind to think like that. Because if you think living is all about living here, then you've misunderstood what living is about. Living is about being born again and living for Christ. So he says here, they shall kill you and shall be... And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Because of me, Jesus said, because of my principles, because of my doctrine, you will be hated of all nations. It's those Christians, is what was said here last year, that's spreading the virus. Really, that's what they said. You Christians are the ones who are doing this. Because you won't stay home and you keep going to your church believing that your God's going to heal you. And they were blaming it on Christians. Because you keep singing in your church. Well, how about we just go to my house and we'll have church in my house? Oh, no, we don't even want that, because then you'll mess the neighborhood up. What they basically are saying is, we hate you so much, we want you to be non-existing. And Jesus said, they will hate you for my name's sake. And then in verse 10, he says, and then shall many be offended. All right, so here it is. And because of the offense, this is why I'm encouraging you tonight to develop a plan to strengthen your faith. So that your faith does not give up when things don't go the way you thought or you prayed they should go. I hear it all the time. Well, I prayed and God didn't do it. Well, again, maybe he knows something you don't know. And we get mad at God because he makes a decision based upon love, absolute perfect love toward us. The Bible says no evil, no gift of darkness comes down from the Father above, only the gifts of light and truth and love. And God never puts a gift of hatred or pain upon you. And if God ever allows you to have pain, it's because there's a reason behind it you can't see on this side. Just be patient. One day you'll understand it all and you'll say, God, you are worthy to be glorified. Well, I prayed for this and he died or she died. Don't give up Christ because your feelings got hurt or your pride got hurt or you thought prophetically that this was going to happen this way or that way. Listen, trust God. And if he makes a decision on your lives, it's because it's the best decision. Hello, somebody. But the world wants you to believe that if God didn't do what you prayed and what you prophesied, then God's not worthy to be trusted. And that's not true at all. That's a lie from hell. So let's look quickly so I can close. And then shall many be offended and shall do what? Betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure until the end, the same shall be saved. Now, I want you to know two things. There's two things here I want you to look at, two paradigms. And that is the end of time and the end of your life. Both of them are the end. So he could be talking about either one of these ends. You understand that? Some of you won't be here to the end of time. Hopefully, I won't either. I'll be caught up to meet him. Amen. Maybe we ought to start singing that song again. Caught up to meet him, you know. But there are two ends, the end of time and the end of your life. But whichever end you come to, that you will be found still having faith and still trusting God, even if you're laying on a deathbed, while others think you should be cursing God, you're saying, Lord, I'm ready to come. I'm ready to go home. I don't understand the mindset. How can you be like that? Because I have faith. And I didn't let the devil drain my faith out, even though sickness may have gotten my body. You see, the way we look at the scripture, we have to look at it from the Holy Spirit's point of view. How does one endure the test of time? Well, by holding on to the very foundations of Christianity, and that's the word of the Lord, first of all. in a relationship with God through Christ Jesus by prayer. Prayer is the development of your relationship with Jesus. Prayer brings you closer to Him and Him closer to you. The Word puts His mind in your mind and washes you with the washing of the water by the Word so that you could endure the test of time, so that you could endure difficult times. But you will not give up because everyone that you knew have walked out of your life. You know, I was in L.A., I think Sunday night, Monday, and then Tuesday I came back. I had a couple of meetings and a funeral up there with one of the pastors. And I was driving through the Silver Lake District, Echo Park, and my uncle used to live there. And I remember before I was married to Pastor Sarah, that I used to go there when I had to preach up there and do meetings. I would go there and stay at their house. It was cheaper than a hotel. And it was my uncle. And we used to always get together and afterwards and talk and go eat. And it was just such a good man. Good man. And when I was driving through there, I had to keep from crying as I drove by Silver Lake District when I thought, oh, I so miss him. Don't miss him on an everyday level, but I miss him because he was uncle. I miss him a bit just to call him on the whim and say, hey, how you doing? How I'm doing. This is what I'm going through. This is what you're going through. And then the privilege of leading him to Jesus. And then one day they find him on the floor and he's gone. And you look at your life, the longer you're alive, and a lot of people are leaving, except you. You're still here. And you're not here because of divine mistake, but by divine appointment. That God knows what He's doing. And that God hasn't forgotten you. And it's not your time to go yet. And you're going to have to just endure it until the end. I told my wife today that I'll probably be one of them people that God will get every penny out of me. I'll be burying some of you folks. Amen. Hallelujah. You're going to get every penny out of me and make me an old man. Make me an old man. And use me up. And then maybe 101 or so, you may say, come on. Come on home. Now, that can change. This depends on Putin. All right. That's my inspiration, amen. At least I'm pushing toward that mark. Yeah, if I get to 86, but I'll take that. Glory to God, hallelujah. But I'm pushing to 101. Some of you will be pushing me out of here by 99, like you got to go, preacher. Most people get old and get weaker. You're getting stronger and meaner. Hello. Where are they? Bring them in here. Sit them down, sinner. All right. We hold on to the day of Jesus Christ. Colossians chapter 1 verse 23 says these words. He says, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled. Did you hear what he said? Grounded and settled. That means you've got to, you know, some of you construction workers, you know when you're building something, you're doing something. You know, I was at the privilege of watching Armando's construction team at my house. They were building the deck and they were doing stuff. And you know, I was out there. My wife said, get away, you're supervised. I said, I'm not supervised. I'm just watching. I'm curious about construction. No, you're just in their way. But I was so amazed of Armando's wisdom and what things have to be and the levels and the structure. And I'm thinking, this big old beam, how's he going to get that thing up there? But they did. They got everything up there and they did all that. You see, when a man or woman is building something that should last, they've got to build deep in order to have the footing they need to be able to endure and withstand any type of wind or shaking, particularly in an earthquake zone. And life is filled with earthquakes. And Jesus wants you and I, if we're going to endure, that we're going to have to build deeper than what we have been doing. You understand what I just said? You know, casual Christianity is not going to get it. You got to get a little more serious about this thing, following Jesus. And so he says here, grounded and settled and be not moved away. Why does he say that? Because there will be many who will try to move you away from your extreme faith. Or you're radical. You actually believe that Jesus is going to come in the sky and take everybody away? And they laugh at that. I believe Jesus is going to come in the sky and he's going to take those who want to go with him away. How many of you want to go with him? Hallelujah. I want to go with him, man. Glory. I believe the word of God still. People got more faith in space aliens and Area 51. If there was anything in Area 51, they already brought it out already. And if there's anything there that's hovering, it's probably something man-built. Hello. People are like, well, I want to see Area 51. I want to see beyond the kingdom gate. So he says here, be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, wherefore I, Paul, am made a minister. Satan, let me just say that. Satan will always bring special ministers to disrupt your faith. Be careful of people trying to get into your life who you don't know. Oh, well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, well, I go to the church down the street. Hey, let's just be friendly. Let's come to your house and we can cook. Bring our kids. What do you know about them? What do they even believe? Huh? Somebody want to partner up with you. Want you to, you know, partner up with them. But that you don't know anything about what they believe. I'm not saying that you become paranoid. I'm just simply saying just get to know folks before you validate folks. I'm very careful, and I have to be very careful because there are always people trying to get into my inner circle. And I have to keep that inner circle because, you know, I've done the pastor free for all, everybody can just come and hang in my house. No, I've done that. And Pastor and I, we don't do that anymore. Because all that we ever got out of there was people get offended because they find out that I didn't wear a suit at home. Or I nodded while I'm watching TV or whatever there. You know, like, oh my God, he nodded. He was not as spiritual as I thought. And I discovered that it's best to have a smaller circle of trusted friends than to have a great circle of many who want to just glean and see what they can get from you. That's just my policy. That doesn't mean I'm not friendly. Doesn't mean I won't hug you, won't get with you and hug you and talk to you and pray with you. But I just, you know, if I just need a time out and say, hey, I'm going to go to, you know, someplace, I'll take one of my guys and friends that we go and we just get away. Because they've been proven and trusted and tried and saw my tears and saw my pain and they still hung out with me. So we've got to be very careful when we open ourselves up to people that we don't know. The Bible says that Satan, in 2 Corinthians, it talks about Satan, no great thing for his ministers to transform themselves. There's a lot of people. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 3, it tells us to be careful to mark them so that we're not caught off unaware. You know, I remember a time when I received a scholarship to go to a college up in Los Angeles, a full-scale scholarship from wonderful, gracious people. I don't want to use their names. They're good folks. Some of them probably gone on home to heaven already. But because of the way it all came out, I took the scholarship, and when I got up to Los Angeles and was inside of the dormitory or the place I was going to be living, and I discovered that the people that I was going to be living with were getting ready to graduate, and they were 4 years into the college, and they were immoral. I packed what little belongings I could that same night and got out of there and came home. And I was criticized for it. I was told I was unappreciative, and I was not, but I was unappreciative. But I so value my faith that I have to guard my faith at all costs. And I can't get amongst folks that are going to discourage my faith and say, hey, we're all doing this. You might as well join in with us. No, I don't want to be part of that. And because I have made those decisions and many other decisions along my life in ministry of what could I have had and what I could have done and where it could have been, I'm not concerned about that. I'm concerned about walking with the Lord. You know, we had a young woman who came to our ministry, and she was so pure in heart. She loved the Lord. She was on several accounts, but this particular one. And just a new convert. We got her a new convert class, and we were able to minister to her, and she was just such a sweetheart in the ministry. And then another young lady came into our ministry, she got involved real quickly, and she started participating after several months and almost a year. She was really trusted. But this young woman, who was a new convert, had befriended her. And I remember one time in one of the classes I was teaching, and I brought some correction to a certain thing, and the one that I was not addressing, she was offended for the other girl. And I said, how is it so that you are angry with me because of the correction that I had to bring on this one? I said, who's bewitched your mind? And that little sweet girl was no longer sweet, but she became very angry and bitter at me. Long story short, those two girls walked out of our ministry, Arizona, as lesbians. One converted the other. And so you say, oh, goodness gracious. And all we were trying to do was just be loving and kind. And we thought that by opening ourselves up and not saying things when we felt and seen the warning signs. And this is the problems that we often go through as humans. We see warning signs, and we don't want to say anything because we don't want to be presumptuous. So we don't say anything until it's too late. And I remember the day that girl, I said, are you leaving too? And she said, I'm going with her. And then it was discovered. So we have to be very careful to guard our hearts. Guard our faith. You know, I believe that every man and every woman should have a testimony, but I believe that those who are so too anxious to tell you about the dirt they came out of, be careful. They're trying to throw out feelers. You know what I mean? Oh, I used to drink and party and do all that. You too? Yeah, I did too. Oh, thank God he delivered us. Can I get your phone number? Be careful of people that are quickly to tell you all about their business, because they're after more than just that. They're after your faith. Proverbs chapter 4 verse 23 says these words, and I'll close with this scripture. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Keep your heart, because out of the heart are all the issues that we have to deal with in this life. So be careful that you don't let anybody steal your faith. Keep your faith strong in Jesus. Come on, let's give God praise. God bless you at home. Hallelujah.
The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. All men are to call upon Christ. All men are to ask God to save them, to wash them from their sin. The Bible also says in Romans the 10th chapter, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Will you pray a prayer with me right now, a simple prayer, as you watch today's broadcast? Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and be my master and save me from my sin. I confess that I am a sinner and have great need of you. I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. In your name, Jesus. Amen. Friend of mine, if you prayed this prayer, I believe that your name is now written in the Lamb's Book of Life, for the righteousness of God that's in Christ Jesus has come upon you to save you. God bless you, and God bless your family.
Thank you so much for joining us online. If you're interested in supporting our ministry, here are some ways that you can give. You can mail a check to 8705 Echo Drive, La Mesa, California, 91941. You can send money through the Venmo app, fee-free, or use PayPal through our website, wlwc.org.